knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Nematodes, also known as roundworms, are some of the most numerous and important animals on our planet. They are so numerous that by conservative estimates, for every single human, there are at least 57 to 60 billion nematodes, most of which are harmless, microscopic soil dwellers. There are approximately 25,000 described species of nematodes, but it is likely that there are closer to 500,000 total species. They live in the sea, freshwater, and soil. They are found from polar regions to the tropics, from the tops of mountains to the bottom of the sea. At least one species of devil worm, Halicephalobus mephisto, was recovered from a deep rock fracture 2.2 miles underground in South African gold mines. Before their discovery in 2011, the deepest dwelling multicellular organism was detected at less than 1.2 miles underground, and it was long thought that no animal could survive at such depths. And yet, the devil worms seemed perfectly content to survive miles under the Earth's crust in groundwater 3,000 to 12,000 years old. It is likely there are many other subterranean species yet undescribed by science. Of course, nematodes aren't just harmless soil dwellers. About 50% of all described species inhabit saltwater, while a further 25% inhabit soil and freshwater. The remaining 25% are all parasites. They have been found in a wide variety of animals, from insects to domestic animals and even humans. About 15% of all described nematode species parasitize animals, and about 10% parasitize plants, including crops such as carrots, lettuce, and potatoes. Some of the entomopathogenic nematodes, meaning nematodes that parasitize insects, have been found to seriously reduce populations of insect pests and have even been applied as a type of biological pesticide, while others perform essential soil processes, and still others cause massive damage to economically important crops. In order to better explore this diverse phylum, we will go over form and function, reproduction, free living species, nematodes in agriculture, and finally, the importance of C. elegans. All nematodes are triploblastic, bilaterally symmetrical pseudocoelomates. They are cylindrical in shape, flexible with unique body wall muscles, lack cilia, and demonstrate eutele, also known as cell constancy. Eutelic organisms have a fixed number of somatic or non-reproductive cells when they reach sexual maturity. For example, hermaphroditic adults of the species C. elegans will always have exactly 959 somatic cells, while males of the same species will always have 1,031 somatic cells. Note that this only applies to somatic cells. The germ cells, or sex cells, may vary from individual to individual. Most nematodes are microscopic, usually 5 to 100 microns thick and 0.1 to 2.5 millimeters long. However, some free-living species can reach sizes up to 5 centimeters, and some parasitic species can reach lengths of 1 meter or more. In fact, in the 1950s, one species of giant nematode, Placentonema gigantissima, was recorded within the placenta of a sperm whale as being 8.4 meters, or about 28 feet in length, likely the largest nematode ever described. But such sizes are quite rare. Most nematodes have head regions that are distinctly radially symmetrical, in contrast with the rest of their bilaterally symmetrical body, and often come equipped with 3 or 6 lips and a series of teeth. Their outermost layer is their characteristic protective cuticle, under which lies their thin, skin-like epidermis. Underneath the epidermis lies their muscular system, which is comprised mainly of a layer of longitudinal muscle cells. These muscles work in conjunction with the cuticle and fluid-filled pseudocoel to constitute a hydrostatic skeleton. This skeleton provides support for the roundworms by transmitting the force of muscular contraction to the enclosed non-compressible fluid, thus allowing the nematode to move. This hydrostatic skeleton is necessary for many aspects of nematode life history. The digestive system, for example, begins with the oral cavity. Many nematodes have a sharp stylet that they can use to capture prey. Captured prey is moved into the muscular pharynx, where digestive glands produce enzymes that start to break it down. Nematodes have no stomach, and the pharynx instead connects to muscleless intestine that runs the length of the body and terminates at the rectum and anus. Since there are no muscles in the intestine, the food that moves through the digestive system does so by movements of the body mediated by the hydrostatic skeleton. Nematodes excrete nitrogenous waste through their body walls and lack any excretory organs. Their nervous system is made of a dense circular nerve ring which surrounds the pharynx and acts as the brain. Several smaller nerve cords extend anteriorly towards the oral cavity, and larger nerve cords extend posteriorly. The largest of these is the ventral nerve cord. Nematodes are also covered in sensory bristles that provide a sense of touch, and smaller organs known as amphids, which are responsible for chemoreception. Most species of nematodes are dioecious, meaning male or female, or androdioecious, where most individuals are hermaphroditic, except for rare males that only display one sex. Males are often smaller than females and hermaphrodites, and are equipped with a pair of copulatory spicules that are inserted into the genital pore of the female. The fertilization process is internal, and fertilized eggs are stored in the uterus. Though nematode reproduction is often sexual, hermaphroditic individuals are capable of self-fertilization. In most free-living nematodes, the eggs develop directly into larvae, which closely resemble miniaturized versions of the parents, just with an underdeveloped reproductive system. Most species lay microscopic eggs that are protected by a tough outer shell, though some species, like C. elegans, instead display a behavior known as worm bagging or facultative viviparity, where fertilized eggs hatch inside the parent and the larvae then consume their parent from within to emerge as juveniles. Regardless of how the juveniles hatch, after 4 molts of their outer cuticle, they are sexually mature adults. In parasitic species, reproduction is quite a bit more complicated and often involves several hosts, changes in morphology, and a variety of different eggs. Filarial worms, for example, have different life stages in mosquitoes and humans and cycle between the two hosts to further infection. The majority of nematodes are free-living marine species, and a significant portion are terrestrial or freshwater-dwelling. By some estimates, they make up more than 90% of all species living on the ocean floor, though they are often ignored in favor of larger, charismatic abyssal dwellers. Their abundance and importance on our planet cannot be overstated. Some are herbivores. Others are fungivores, bacterivores, or predators. They provide an important ecological link, as a great deal of them are prey for larger soil-dwelling organisms. Some are even eaten by specially adapted predatory fungi that specialize in consuming nematodes. Some trap adult nematodes, others feed on eggs, and still others produce toxins or invade the nematode pseudocoelom. In the soil, nematodes are extremely important nutrient cyclers that play an essential role in the decomposition process. They regulate the populations of other soil organisms, mineralize nutrients into plant-available forms, provide a food source for other soil organisms, and consume disease-causing organisms. For example, when a bacterium-feeding nematode consumes a disease-causing bacterium, the nematode not only eliminates the pest, but also excretes excess nitrogen in the form of ammonium, which is a plant-available form of nitrogen that aids in plant growth. Other species of nematodes play similar but distinct roles in freshwater and marine systems, where they are especially important in the decomposition process. But others also cycle nutrients, feed on algae and microscopic diatoms, stimulate nutrient remineralization, and also serve as indicators of biological health, since some species are very sensitive to pollution. Other species of nematodes live in our food, like the vinegar eel that was first discovered in unfiltered vinegar. It has been found to survive in a pH range of less than 1.6, which is lower than stomach acid or pure lemon juice, and up to 11, about as basic as ammonia. Thankfully, they are harmless, non-parasitic, and filtered out of most vinegar. Unfortunately, not all species of nematodes are free-living. Some species of nematodes are significant agricultural pests that can parasitize crops and cause significant damage. The root knot nematodes, for example, are often considered some of the most damaging pests to household gardens. Unlike most pests, they are generalists rather than specialists and can parasitize more than 2,000 plant species. They enter plant roots as larvae, mature and mate within the roots, and lay eggs in the surrounding soil. The galls, or knots, damage the plants by blocking the flow of water and nutrients and allowing pathogens to invade. Another common nematode pest are root lesion nematodes, which damage fruit trees and broad-acre crops like cereals. There, they burrow into roots and extract cell nutrients, damaging feeder roots and causing the plant to create a weak, shallow root system with many dead or drying areas. However, not all nematodes negatively impact crops. In addition to the thousands of species of harmless soil-dwelling nematodes, there are also entomopathogenic species which selectively parasitize insects. Some infect larval forms, and others infect adults. They have been found all over the world and are highly diverse, complex, and specialized. They have been used as a form of biological control and spread by farmers through crops infested with specific insects. They act kind of like a living pesticide, and they don't leave any chemical traces. Since they are microscopic, they can be applied to crops using a variety of pressurized sprayers, alongside or instead of traditional pesticides and fertilizers. However, although they have been used since the 1980s, there is a lack of fundamental research on the potential for their widespread use. Though they can easily be mass-produced and selectively target pest species, there are still some concerns about their long-term continued use in agriculture. However, they could serve as non-toxic alternatives to some current pesticides. The last species of nematode we will mention here is C. elegans, perhaps the most scientifically significant species of nematode. C. elegans is a free-living transparent nematode about 1 millimeter in length that is common in temperate soil environments. It was the first multicellular organism to have its entire genome completely mapped, and it is currently the only organism to have its connectome completed, which is a map of brain connections. The origin and lineage of all the cells of its body have been traced from zygote to adult, and it has been used as a model organism in studies regarding cell lineage mapping, programmed cell death, RNA interference and gene silencing, cell division and the cell cycle, drug abuse and addiction, aging, sleep, sensory biology, and even spaceflight research. Many advances in gene function, whole genome research, and a great deal of other fields owe their discovery to C. elegans. There's still a lot more to say about the nematodes, namely those which parasitize humans, so let's move forward and get a look at those next.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.